Hello, I'm Doug, and this is the Taste and Sensibility channel. And today we're not reviewing varietal honeys or black licorice, but we're looking at one bourbon, one scotch, and one beer. I do a lot of tasting of various adult beverages, including all sorts of world whiskies, rums, mezcals, cognacs, armagnacs, brandies. I find lots of them very interesting. But I'm not going to be reviewing most of those things on the channel. Partly because the whisky space on YouTube is so crowded with so many people trying to get some traction for their channels and their reviews. But I do want to pop in every once in a while, like in between series, and show you what's grabbed my attention recently. Hence the title that will only be three or four times a year probably, of one bourbon, one scotch, and one beer. I always thought it was a George Thorogood song, and then I did a little research and found it was somebody else's song. But back then it was called One Scotch, One Bourbon, One Beer. But I'm gonna do it in the George Thorogood style here. And I'll throw in a little music if I can come up with some way to fool YouTube about where it came from. But today, first up on the list is Old Ezra. 7-year-old bourbon. I've got a 101 proof and I have a cask strength version. But let me pour that and let it get going. My glass here is from the New Orleans Bourbon Festival, which I attended a couple months ago. So I am pouring Old Ezra, aged 7 years, Kentucky straight bourbon whiskey, distilled and aged in Kentucky for Lux Row Distillers, Bardstown, Kentucky. Barrel strength, 58.5% by volume, 117 proof. So I've been liking this, and apparently I've been liking the 101 even more, because it's even more gone. But the branding and labeling are totally inconsistent and different. The other reviewers were saying when this came out in the 50s, it was to compete with Jack Daniel's. So you see a square bottle, you see a 7 on the front, and it was just a knockoff copy, and it wasn't very good. And here, this is a serious bourbon, designed, I'm sure, for the bourbon craze right now. But this, I'm finding very good, and the 101 version is also nice. But looks like it's aimed for two different audiences. So, anyway, just an interesting note. But I'm finding this fully the quality level of all the big boys, Elijah Craig and Booker's and Four Roses and all those. Have another competitor. And I think I like the barrel strength a little more than the 101. A little more complex, more interesting. Gives the nose of typical bourbon notes. You can tell maybe there's brown sugar, caramel, vanilla. Can't really detect the 58.5. Can't really pick up the 117 proof. And on the palate, you get the same sort of brown sugary, caramel, maybe a cherry, and vanillas like most bourbons have. But the taste profile is just a little bit different than all the ones that we're used to. This one's very nice, different, might appeal to some people more than something they're currently enjoying. So I'd say it's worth a try. So I haven't figured out the sourcing or the origin of the juice inside. But on one bottle it says Ezra Brooks is a St. Louis company and it's distilled for them. And on the other bottle it says distilled and bottled for Lux Row, which is based in Bardstown, Kentucky. So I think they have a Kentucky connection. One of the big distilleries is doing something very nice for them. So it's worth checking out. Now, the next item we have here is a Scotch whiskey from Bruichladdich, which is on the island of Islay. Islay is known for smoky, peaty whiskies, but this particular version is not peated, it's not smoky. It's just a simple, unadorned malt, but it's made from local barley all grown on Islay. So let me get this pouring and maybe sitting in a glass with some water. The Bruichladdich does not chill filter or color their whiskey. They put out most expressions at 50% ABV. This particular batch was batched in, distilled in 2010, and just, I think they bottled it after 6 years. This came to my attention a couple years ago when I bought the 2007 expression. So I have one unopened bottle of the 2007, which is getting rare and hard to come by. And they only list Rockside Farm as the source of the barley for the Islay Barley Edition of Bruichladdich. So Bruichladdich is really a craft distillery. They're careful. They pay attention to every little thing. They do everything in the house. So they get the barley from the farmer and they malt it there in-house. Then they do the fermentation and the distillation and put it in the barrels and age. And this is doesn't give you the impression that it's a six-year scotch. This is a little more complex, and you get all the marine notes and saltiness of the Islay scotches that scotch drinkers are used to. Oh wow, on the nose you get malty and marine. It smells salty. So 2010 is the most recent version that's out in the stores, so it's easy to pick up right now if your store has Bruichladdich products. Malt, malt, malt. So I see it in grocery stores, liquor stores, all sorts of establishments. I still see a little of the 2009 around. I bought a couple of bottles of that and it was a little disappointing compared to the 2007. But this one is surprising me. This one is grabbing my attention because it's on that level of the 2007. It's different, it's unique, and I'm not sure I have words for describing how it's different. Whereas the Rockside Farm was the only source of the barley for the first one, I think their volume has grown because this one is Cool, Cuach, Dunlosset, Island, Mullendry, Rockside, Starch Mill, and Sunderland are all the farms that need to take part to supply all the barley for this increased demand, I think. So the 2010 is better than the 2009 and is good and different than the 2007 was. So this is worth a look if you're into single malts and into Scotch whiskey. It's got the Islay nose. It's like a walk on the beach. You taste, you smell and taste the seashore. Seaweed. Oysters. Things running around in the sand. You know you're at the seashore. You know you're by the ocean. And I pick it up here. And it seems a little salty. So this is wonderful whiskey for sipping and just enjoying. It's unadorned. It's not sherried. It's not peated. It's got none of those special things that people like to go on and on about. They just put it into ex-bourbon casks and let it age in Islay for 6 years. And it turns out great. You don't need a big number as an age statement. You don't need fancy finishes or fancy casks. You just need good oak. like U.S. bourbon companies send them. So this is excellent and worth looking out for. And I find it's about 55, 60 bucks. U.S. here in the New Orleans area. Pause, or just drink beer. This is so good, I can't stop drinking it. I'm ready to move on to the beer, but I want to finish this. This is so good. Malty, salty, intense, direct, fresh, energetic. Tastes youthful, but not the usual way. Energetic is a good word. And 50% ABV lets you know it's there. I love Bruichladdich. It really is a craft distillery. They're known for Port Charlotte is a peated expression. They're known for Octomore. And those are made in such small quantities, they have to charge a couple hundred bucks a bottle. This stuff is on a grocery store shelves in New Orleans, so they make a bundle of this. And it takes 7 or 8 farms of worth of barley to produce it all now that the demand is up. Everyone knows how good Bruichladdich is. Okay, I'm sorry it's gone, but I can move on to the beer now. And finally, the beer I like is called Royal Tea from Port Orleans Brewery. This is a local brewery in New Orleans. I discovered this on an outing with a couple of friends. We often take once a quarter maybe, we take a Friday afternoon off and go visit a local brewery and try to get a brewery tour if we can. And just have a nice lunch together, enjoy 3 or 4 different things we haven't tasted before. This particular day, we went to Port Orleans Brewery, which is on Chapultepec Street, down in the city of New Orleans. And we both ordered, all three of us ordered flights of 4 beers. So I tasted 4 different things, and my buddies tasted 4 different things. But this was in their flights, not on mine. I got a taste of theirs. Thank you, AC, for coming on in the middle of a talk. But I'll just stick it out and see if it works. So, I got a taste of theirs and thought, whoa, that's different, that's nice, I like that, and I bought a 6-pack. And this is one of the last few bottles. So I'm gonna be pouring this and letting you know why it's different and why it's called Royal Tea. So this is a bergamot containing brew. It's a citrus, it's an orangey thing that's in Earl Grey tea. And that's what makes Earl Grey distinctive. So after we get rid of some foam. So Port Orleans has lots of different brews and different kinds, and it's very complicated. You need a roadmap to go there, and the need flights of 4 to discover all that they have and work your way around their menu. And they have a really good tasting room. Nice patio outside and a nice big tasting room inside with TVs and sports, and they can do all sorts of things right there at the brewery. And we didn't really look into tours that day. We just did lunch and sat around and drank beer and talked. But anyway, that's a little hoppy. Smells like a beer. I need to get through to the foam. I don't usually do beer reviews or beer tasting, so I haven't watched others. I should watch Trini and see. They're some of my favorite whiskey reviewers, but I haven't watched their beer reviews. So there's a hint of that bergamot flavor. You can tell it's a little citrusy, a little acidic, and it's the Earl Grey tea flavor. And I do tea quite a bit, so it's hard to imagine me not doing some sort of tea series sometime in the future. But this royal tea has an interesting twist. It's very flavorful. It's not very hoppy. I smelled it more than I tasted it. It's not real bitter. It's grainy, a little malty, and the bergamot just gives it a little bit of pop. So that's something I've been enjoying for several months, and I'll probably get some more. So thank you so much for watching, and if you like the reviews that you've been seeing here, whether they're for honey or black licorice or whiskey advent calendars or this mess, then give it a thumbs up or a thumbs down or leave some comment down below. Register your complaints. Subscribe to the channel and click that bell icon to get notified every time a new video is released, usually Mondays and Thursdays. So, I guess the next time you see me, we'll be diving into black licorice. So, get ready for that, and that's all for now.